welcome to Elements of Ayurveda, Empowering Wisdom of Life. I'm your host, Colette, and in this podcast, I hope to empower you to take charge of your own health by sharing the holistic teachings of Ayurveda, the ancient healing tradition from India. We will also discuss topics like health and wellness, nutrition, yoga, fitness, meditation, breathwork, and much more, as well as interviewing lots of inspiring people along the way. My humble wish is to help you to connect to your true nature, to Mother Nature, and to each other. If you like the content, be sure to subscribe to the show, and the new episodes will automatically download for you to enjoy. If you're new to Ayurveda, I recommend you listen to the first couple of episodes where I do an introduction to Ayurveda and the mind-body types. I've also set up a Facebook group for us to connect and to support each other, and I'd love for you to join me over at Elements of Ayurveda podcast group. And now, here's the show. Hello, and welcome to Elements of Ayurveda. It's Colette and Amy here today. Hi, Amy.
Good morning.
How are you?
Nice to hear your voice. I'm feeling great. How are you?
I'm doing very well, thank you. And I'm looking forward to discussing our topic today of the acceptance of aging and conscious aging. And this is a topic very dear to my heart because I really feel an affinity towards the elderly. And as I was saying to you a few moments ago, Amy, before we started recording, it's like I have this thing where if I see elderly people, particularly elderly men, because I feel, I feel women can get on with it and are more self-sufficient. But if I see an elderly man, my heart just breaks and I really worry about them if they're on their own. And I have a lot of, here in the village, a lot of elderly men in particular who, you know, when I'm down the beach in the morning working out, they stop by and I'm always checking in on them. But it's just this, my heart breaks for them. And my friends are like, they're fine. There's nothing wrong with them. But I just, I feel that in our society today, that we don't really respect the elderly as much. You know, it's kind of like they've lost their value, right, in quotes, in our society. And we really don't respect the elderly. You know, in the West, we worship youth and we don't even like to discuss aging. And we're always trying to cover it up. You know, the anti-aging business, the Botox, the creams, the plastic surgery is really a booming business. So it's almost like we have a fear of old age. And I think just that fear itself brings about stress, which can accelerate aging even more. What are your thoughts, Amy, about aging and about how our society views aging?
You know, since I was a little girl, I always loved older people. Like I never seemed to fit into my age group. Like when I was in my late 20s, I was interested in hanging out with people who were in their 50s. And in my 30s, it was 60. And now I'm close to 50 and I'm really like fascinated by hanging out with 70 and 80 year olds. Mm-hmm, I find them so wise and so interesting. And, you know, I've got all this pitta and I out there in the world doing my thing, thinking I know what I'm talking about. And then I'll talk to one of my elderly mentors. I have a couple of them in their 70s. And they'll just like softly throw some advice at me that just stops me in my tracks. And I'm like, oh, you better listen to this girl.
Right.
So I know society in general seems to kind of throw people away when they're perceived to no longer be of use. Mm. But I personally, I would much rather hang out with a 70 or 80 year old for an evening and have a nice long talk than go out to a bar or even a noisy restaurant. Who wants to do that?
Right. I totally agree. I could sit and chat with some elderly folk for hours. I love hearing the stories. And I don't know about you, but I want my influencer to have some life wisdom and years under their belt if they're going to give me some advice, you know, in our world today, we have these influencers often very young and giving advice, which, you know, maybe they have some experience to share, but I want my influencer to have some years behind them.
So why, I mean, you and I agree on this. Why do you think society in general, is it because it's a little more work to help them get through their day? Is it because they maybe talk more slowly and we're just so riled up that we don't want to slow down for that conversation? What is it that, is it a reminder that we too will get old and pass one day, and that's so uncomfortable to us? Yeah. What do you think it is?
Well, I think, yes, there is, you know, we're in a rush society, you know, we're always want things fast and we don't have time for the elderly. But I think it's on a deeper level that spiritually we're not accepting that this is our future, that this is where we're heading. And I think there's a huge fear of aging. And we're constantly trying to cover it up. We're constantly trying to, you know, get rid of any signs of aging and put elderly people away in homes, away from society, so we don't even have to look at it. And so I do think on a deep level, we just haven't accepted. And there does come a time in your life when you realize, you know, that, okay, this is my future. And it's kind of all of a sudden it hits you. I just turned 30, I was going to say 35. I just turned 45 recently. In my mind, I'm 35.
See, you're doing it. You don't even want to age.
I know, right? But yeah, I just turned 45 and I have no issue with my age or aging. I don't, you know, I don't get agitated about it in any way. But there is you see the wrinkles coming in, you see your body, the shell, aging. And there is an acceptance that has to happen, that this is, you know, this is the process. And I think for many of us, we don't even want to hear about it and we don't want to accept it. And this leads to greater turmoil down the line when we're faced with our aging process, when you can no longer ignore it.
You know, and it's so interesting. I think where you live really programs your beliefs and your values. And so I live up in a small mountain town in California and, you know, literally just a few hundred people in my little town. Yeah. And I feel fine with my wrinkles and my gray hair and my little belly, and you know, I feel comfortable in my skin. But then I go to teach in LA. And suddenly I become so self-conscious because it's very clear that people have had a lot of different surgeries on faces and body parts. And there is this almost fear of not looking the same. Of course, we're not going to look the same, but it's so prevalent there.
Yeah, it is.
And then it starts to creep in and I start feeling insecure. And I think, oh my gosh, I have to get out of here because I don't want to be programmed that way.
Yeah, no, I agree. And having lived, you know, past 3 years in California, it was definitely eye-opening the amount of work that people are having done. And yeah, I hear you. And of course, our media is setting us up for revering youth, right? You very rarely see elderly people on the cover of the magazines. And it's just society as a whole is really geared toward the youth. And even after, you know, the age of 50, we're not even advertised to anymore at that age. You're really ignored by society, even trying to get work. How many of my friends who are 50 plus trying to find work? It's really hard.
I'll agree with that. I see such talented, wise, competent people that are just not even, and it's not like they would even demand to make a whole lot more money than the younger person. They'd just be happy for life purpose and a job, and they just get passed by. It's kind of incredible to watch and sad to watch.
Yeah. And such wasted wisdom.
Such wasted wisdom. And isn't that the crux of what we're talking about today, is that the life experience, the wisdom that we gain as human beings in this lifetime is so important to pass on to younger generations and to help us not, as a society, make the same mistakes over and over and over. And I'm just blown down that none of us are valuing that beautiful wisdom and that sitting for tea with someone and just being with them.
Right.
It's so interesting that we don't value it.
No, absolutely. And, you know, the thing is that the way to deal with the future, and we're really seeing this now in our world, is with understanding the wisdom from the past. Look how we're reaching back to the teachings of yoga and Ayurveda to find our way in this modern world. You know, in Ayurveda, it says that postmenopause is the wisdom stage of life, and what we give up in youth, we gain in wisdom. And that's a beautiful way of looking at it. And it's more of an introspective time and more of a time of just being rather than out there doing, like in the Pitta stage, where we're building a career and a family and we're buying and lots of materialism and showing off to the neighbors of what we have. And it's very prideful time at the Pitta stage. Whereas when we come into the Vata stage of life, it's more of a spiritual journey, and there's more introspection and more philosophical view on life and less value in things. And you know, it's so interesting that we are now really searching and looking back to these ancient traditions and to ancient indigenous cultures of how they did things, because we're so lost right now.
You know, it's reminded me of when I teach my yoga students Patanjali's Yoga Sutras. There's four chapters, and the first three chapters, everyone is so excited and loves the Yoga Sutras, and what a beautiful guide for life. And then we get to the fourth chapter, and we start talking about surrender and letting go and detachment, and basically the way to the truth, the way to, you know, Kaivalyam, is to have less attachments, less desire, less fear, less, you know, all of, just let everything go. Yeah. And just be with your Purusha, be with your soul. And as soon as we get to those, the students say, oh my God, is that where this is headed? Maybe I don't want to learn Yoga Sutra. What? I didn't know this is where it was going, right. You know? And I say, wow, it's beautiful to me to think about living with less, simplifying. I mean, I wish I did more of it. I threw out 8 bags of clothes yesterday from my closet, and wow, it felt so good. I was like, oh, get it gone. And, yeah, you know, ultimately we're going to let go of our looks. We're going to let go of our sharp mind. We're going to have to let go of relationships, you know. And can we find the beauty in that, and the stillness in that, and the simplicity in that?
Yeah, and there's so much to look forward to as we age as well, because it is not only that letting go, but caring less about what people think of you. Mm-hmm. And also there's more of showing your true colors. I remember somebody described aging as, you know, the trees, the leaves on the trees as you go through autumn into winter, where in the prime of life they're green and they're really vivid colors. And then as you go through the aging process, the leaves show their true colors. So they go from green to yellow and gold and red, all these gorgeous colors. And this is like us when we get older, that we're showing now our true selves, and there's less of this trying to fit in and, you know, trying to fit into society, do the job, you know, get the car and so on, all those things, you know, the boxes, ticking the boxes. So when you get to your elder years, there's more of a showing of your true colors, and there's really wanting at that stage to really make a purpose, if you haven't already done so, really find that you can make a difference or make a purpose in your own way in this world. And then there's, you know, a drying of the body, and then eventually the leaves fall off the trees and we pass. But I do think there's so much to look forward to, and that's in the stage of life where you have less responsibilities as well. So you get an opportunity to really do what you want to do, because your kids are grown up, you may have an empty nest. And now it's like, okay, what do I want to do? For the first time, maybe in your life, you get to see what is it you really want to do.
Yeah, I've actually been going through a similar transition. I have achieved, you know, all that I've wanted as a householder in my middle life. It's been a wonderful 25-year career. And I'm not saying I won't keep working, but I'm just saying this driving you know, the green leaf.
Yeah.
I'm starting to feel like, okay, now I want to be me and show my true colors and speak my values and speak my beliefs. And we've done a little bit of that on your show.
Yeah, I love it.
And not care so much what people think. And if it hurts me professionally, oh well. Yeah. If you don't like me, it's okay. So I feel like even, you know, moving into menopause and moving into my 50s, I am so ready to be a golden red leaf that not everybody appreciates and but I love myself. And so it's so true, the stages of life. And I think it's a privilege to have gotten to this phase where
Absolutely.
I can just allow myself to be me and not be such a people pleaser. It's glorious. I'm loving it so far.
Absolutely. And when I talk to clients who are elderly, you know, I'm like, this is your opportunity to do what you want to do, especially if they've raised a family and, you know, now they're finding more time on their hands. I'm like, what did you give up when you had children? And oftentimes it's something creative, which in the Vata stage of life, it's a great time because that Vata energy is very creative to get back into creative work and to let that be a meditative practice and let that inspiration flow through. And so a lot of my elderly clients pick up craft work or painting or sketching or gardening, things that they let go when they were too busy in the pitta stage of life. And so it's really time to nourish and what you love to do and had to let go of.
You know, I've often thought that I'm really grateful I'm such an introvert because I think, at least watching my dad, who's very much an introvert too, he was a very public figure his whole life, and he is loving retirement because he sits in his big chair with all of his books surrounding him, and he has this very rich inner landscape. Mm-hmm. He could entertain himself, you know, 365 days a year because he's such an introvert and has developed that inner sense of exploration and wonder and adventure inside his own brain. So I wonder if anybody's ever done any research on that to show if introverts versus extroverts fare better. Because then the other side of the coin is elderly are oftentimes very, very lonely. And yeah. I know there's research to support that when you stay in community, when you have people you see every day, like the little men that come to see you at the beach, that actually matters in terms of mental and physical health.
Oh, absolutely. And I think that's it. I think there is a lot in the Vata stage, you know, with Vata, it can come loneliness when Vata is out of balance and that feeling of isolation. And that is heightened even more for an elderly person if they don't have much social contact anymore. Because what is it like when you go from being a person who's out in the world, you have a job, you have family, and then all of a sudden you find yourself that, you know, you are of no use, right, in our society, that you're not valuable anymore. That's such a terrible fall for a person. And I find it in particular with clients that are going from the pitta, who are high pitta constitution in the pitta stage of life, right? So really driven. And now they're going into the vata stage of life. They're going through menopause or postmenopause. And now it's this real battle. Because that pitta, it's almost like the ego as well, doesn't want to let go of the striving and the pushing and the achieving. But the vata's coming in and saying, come on, you know, it's like the soul, the old soul's coming in going, come on, let's slow down a little here. Give me a break and let's ease into this a little bit more. And that's something I've really noticed a lot, particularly that when it comes from a person with a high pitta constitution, that really pushing has a hard time giving up.
Yeah, I have a really close friend who's in her 70s and just retired from teaching. And I think she's having a hard time. She's texting me and say, I don't know who I am. I no longer have my identity. And I'm just encouraging her to do more meditation, do more yoga, spend time with family, find hobbies, stay connected. Like this can be a beautiful time of life. And in fact, she knows I am envious of her. Like, oh my gosh, You still get almost your whole paycheck for staying home because you have a great pension? What?
Right. Yeah, but it is. I mean, there has to be a preparation for this stage as well, because people do. You often hear people go into retirement and then they fall ill and pass because there is such a shock to the system and that loss of identity that ego is attached to. You know, I am this job. So I think there has to be a preparation in the pitta stage of life for doing that journey of self-discovery and really delving into that. So when you go through these transitions in life, that it's not such a shock to the system. And I think that that should happen earlier in life. And that happens as well with us seeing elders in our community. And I know growing up in Ireland, we would always have the elderly within our family. And even after they pass, you know, the elderly, the family would prepare the body, or now it's the funeral home, but there would be a wake in the home. So you would see the body. And so there, it was just another stage of life. When I lived in Bali, you know, the elderly would always be in the compound with the family, and the grandmother would be out, you know, placed out on laying down or in the outside in the fresh air and the sun during the day. And again, seeing that life cycle, I think, is important. Whereas now we, you know, again, putting people in old folks' homes or retirement villages on the outskirts of town, we're not seeing that cycle a lot of times.
You know, that's so interesting. You should bring this up. I put a post on Facebook a couple days ago or a week ago saying, is it possible that our loved ones who have passed on are still basically inside of us? Is their prana absorbed by us? Are they one with us? Mm-hmm. And I've had some experiences that tell me, yes, that is what happened. And when you say that the elderly are with the family still, and they get wheeled out into the sunshine, and they still have dinner together, and then when they pass, that they actually have the service in the home. Yeah. I feel very strongly that all of those experiences are kind of making our prana intermingle with one another, and the imprint of that person on us, in us, is much, much stronger. And we take that with us into our lives. We take their qualities, we take their words, we take their hugs, you know, whatever it is, forward with us. And it becomes who we are.
Absolutely. And I think seeing that process of aging and death, like I remember my grandmother, amazing woman, one of my idols, passed at 90 a few years ago. And she would always say to me that, you know, I don't feel like I'm 90, I feel like I'm 60. And that helped me understand that, oh, it's just the shell. It's just the body that's aging, but inside the soul is still young. And that made me understand there that, you know, then that was what was happening. And I feel that now as my body age, I still have to remind myself, okay, I'm a little bit older now, you know, and I catch myself sometimes. But I remember then when I saw my grandmother and, you know, I touched the body and it was freezing cold. And that just reinforced that belief, like, oh yeah, this is just the shell. It's just her house, right? Or her vehicle that she used to get around in the world is gone. It's no longer functioning. It aged, basically. Like the soul, it's just the inner spark. The soul is still living.
Yeah. I feel the same way about my mom who passed this year. Yeah. She is with me like every day. I mean, this same may sound like I'm crazy, but I talk to her multiple times a day and it's like a real conversation. And I just, in my heart, I just feel that her shell gave out.
Yeah.
But she's still here kicking.
Right. And I think that's beautiful. And I think it's a great way of looking at it. It's like, oh yeah, my body is just the vehicle to carry this inner light, this soul. And I think that rather than being attached to the body and how that's aging, it's going to age and we have to accept that, because otherwise we're going to cause major stress physically and mentally if we don't accept that. And if we try to, reverse aging or try to, you know, slow it down or go to all these lengths to to deny it. But so rather than identifying with the body, identify with the soul and do the soul journey and the soul discovery in this lifetime. And I think that's where we get comfort, and that's where we can go through this process of aging with more comfort. I know I find more comfort in knowing that, oh, this is just the shell, and also gives me more comfort in death and dying. And I have less fear of it because I understand, oh, it's just their body gave out. You know,
right.
But the soul is still there.
And interestingly, it's also informing me about how to take care of this shell. That, okay, yeah. This shell does have a limited potential.
Right.
And, you know, how would you like to be in pain, or would you like to exactly. feel light and spacious in this shell for the next 30 years? So I'm kind of going through something right now as I age. That after a pretty, you know, a knee injury, I had chronic pain for a good 6 months. And I was like, oh my goodness, I don't think I can live with chronic pain all day, all night like this. Like, mm-hmm. This is too much.
Right.
So now
it's like
I've gotten
such a toll right on the body.
Yeah. So now I've gotten really interested in how to take care of this shell, not out of vanity, but out of, I want to actually feel good the next 30 years if I'm lucky enough to be around that long.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Yes. And we have to take care of it. And it's, again, that's our responsibility. We have to accept aging, accept our limitations, and, but at the same time, not to give up. You know,
right.
Sometimes I've heard elderly people say, well, I'm in the waiting room now. Oh my goodness. When I hear that, I'm like, stop it. Don't
yeah.
say that, you know, because it is a lot about your attitude to it. So how do we do conscious aging then? How do we go into the aging process, being conscious, being accepting, letting go? What are your thoughts on that?
It's very interesting. I mean, what I'm thinking a lot about lately is just being grateful for the moment I have, because my mother passed so unexpectedly.
Yeah.
I just am telling myself, like, Amy, there's no guarantees mm-hmm. for tomorrow. So, mm-hmm. you know, whatever you're doing at this moment, you better enjoy it. You should enjoy every hug from my husband, right. every purr from my cat, mm-hmm. enjoy the smell of the lotion that I put on my arms, enjoy the podcast, like be 100% in. So I don't know if that answers your question.
No, it does. Yeah. Just being in present moment. Yeah.
Yeah. I feel like however many moments I have, this is kind of like the first time in my life where I've been able to get myself to not be so far in the future and just to kind of be like, okay, what do we have on our plate today? And can we love every single minute of that day? And to me, that I think so far is conscious aging.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I agree. And just being, instead of worrying about the future, being in the present moment and appreciating everything, because you definitely got a shock in the past few months when your mom passed. And that can definitely jolt you into thinking, oh my goodness, I need to really treasure every moment.
Yeah. So instead of thinking, oh my God, I have 7 more years till I can retire yeah. from my job. Yeah. Now it's like, wow, I get another day mm-hmm. to wake up and make a difference in the world. Mm-hmm. You know, instead of thinking, oh my God, my husband's driving me nuts. You know, right. we're going to be married for 3 more decades. Now yeah. I'm like, oh my gosh, he's so cute.
Yeah.
I'm so happy for him.
Right.
So
yeah,
it just, yeah, changes your perspective.
And honestly does. And I think that if you have children, I think it's good to expose them and talk to them about the elderly and expose them to that wisdom. And, you know, maybe volunteering at different old folks' homes. I used to go when I was in California and do the lunchtime serving, and you'd have great conversations with people. But exposing your child to that, to elderly people, especially if you don't have your parents or grandparents living with you or nearby. And if you can't go, you know, do volunteering somewhere, maybe you can make your children aware of elderly around, so that maybe you're in the parking lot of the grocery store and that you help an elderly person put the bags in the car, and just exposing them in little ways.
Absolutely.
I think that's so, so important. And then for, you know, us who are in the pitta or going the vata stage of life, how can we accept it more? How can we be okay with it and be okay with that aging? I'm not saying, you know, give up totally on yourself. Of course, we have to, like you were saying, Amy, we have to take care of this vehicle. We have to take care of this body and mind and doing all that we can do to make sure that we can age feeling good and feeling active and keeping ourselves vital as well. So we need to look at, you know, the foods we're eating, the environment we're in, the, you know, the stress that's around us. How do we really bring in mindfulness practices to ease those heavy burdens so that we're not accelerating aging? And we need to think of this earlier in life.
Right. I think that's what's been a surprise to me. Even though I'm almost 50, I still feel about 30. And so it's been surprising to me to have chronic pain or to have a knee injury, or I, like, sometimes I look in the mirror, I'm like, oh my gosh, you are, you know,
no, I catch myself close all the time. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, and check that out. I'm not invincible.
Yes. Yes. So it's just coming upon me. I don't know about you, but I'm just starting to really get this opportunity to experience it. And I don't know, I kind of like it. I love the idea of the crone who no longer really has to worry about pleasing anyone and just gets to be herself. Mm-hmm. And to me, that sounds delicious. Right. Like, I have spent a lot of time in my professional life holding my mouth shut, turning the other cheek, pretending that something didn't just happen when there's an elephant in the room, and just trying to go along to get along and denying my true self. Mm-hmm. And I'm kind of looking forward and dipping my toe in the water of being, you know, a woman who doesn't have to people please all the time. And I think it's exciting for me, actually.
Oh yeah. I think there's such freedom in it that when you just get to speak your truth, and you're, like I said earlier, you don't care what people think so much anymore. You're like, this is it.
Yeah. And what do we have to lose? I mean, any of us could go tomorrow. Mm-hmm. And don't we want to have let our true nature shine before that final moment?
Right. Absolutely.
I mean, what a sad life if we kind of hid ourselves to please everyone, and then for some reason we weren't here. I mean, I had a very serious car accident a couple of years ago where I actually had that kind of out of body experience and was looking down at my body. And if that had been my moment, I don't think I had fully expressed my true nature at that point. Mm. And that was kind of a turning point for me, and especially with my mom passing too, that, wow, there's no promises for the future here, girl. Yeah. Like, if you want something, if you want to be something, you go 100% in. Don't have fear. You know, my friend said to me the other day, I love being friends with you because you're so courageous and it gives me courage. And I said, well, yeah, let's do it. 100%. Mm-hmm. I don't do things unless I'm 100%. And really excited about it and wanting to fully experience it in this human body.
Yeah, and I think that's that great, and that needs to start young. And that's where we start understanding our true self. And I think that should start earlier in our life, in the pitta stage mm-hmm. of life, where we understand our mind-body type. We understand our and do that journey of self-discovery and bring that into the world. Because then I think all of a sudden when we are facing aging, when we are maybe post-menopause or going through menopause, it's like, wow, there's all of a sudden there's this realization, there's almost a panic, and there is a real fear that can set in. So I think doing this self-realization earlier in life so that you feel like you've accomplished a lot already by the time that you go through menopause and then into the vata stage of life. Okay, so I'm going to jump in here to tell you about some online courses and services I have that can help you. So for those of you who are interested in starting this journey of self-discovery, I wanted to let you know about a group course I have coming up. It's an online 28-day course, and it's the Daily Habits for Holistic Health program. It starts April 27th. Like I said, it's online. It's a group course. It is self-paced. However, I do like to open it up to a group where we can go do this course together, hold each other accountable, and support each other on this journey. And this course deals with self-care practices. These practices that are great to bring into your life at a young age so that they will support your health and well-being as you go through the aging process. Now, this course is not only about these Dinacharya or self-care practices. I also give a lot of education around the circadian rhythms and understanding the different mental qualities and how to keep your mind in balance, along with the foundations of Ayurvedic healing so that you can have the tools to become your own healer. And we also talk about the journey of self-discovery and really gaining access to your intuition. So if you're interested in joining us on this course, then please click on the link in the show notes, or you can just go to my website, elementshealingandwellbeing.com/daily habits course. Of course, I also provide private consultations if you want to determine your birth constitution or if you want to check in on your current health situation if you have an imbalance. And I also provide private cleanses throughout the year. So please check out the website elementshealingandwellbeing.com, and if you're ready to get started on this journey of self-discovery, well then I would love to support you. Okay, back to the show.
But couldn't we live with that 100% of whatever it is we're doing, even in our later stage of life? I mean, yeah, sure. I remember my grandma, she used to wear these long prairie skirts with tennis shoes, which I thought was hilarious. And now I understand the wisdom of it because it looks so damn comfortable.
Right. See, that's it. It's like, I'm going to wear these tennis shoes with this skirt and I don't care what you all think.
Right. So one day at like 91 years old, I walked into her old folks' home to have a visit with her, and there she was with her boyfriend unbuttoning his shirt.
Oh,
just having
hey now.
A great old time. Hey now. And I was like, you go, Grandma. And so like, that's what I'm talking about. Like even at 90 years old, can you be 100% in, whether you're reading a book or taking a walk in nature or having a visit with your grandkid? Like, can we cultivate this attitude in our younger years where, hey, I'm present, I'm here, I'm loving my life? And can we carry that all the way through to a time when our life is very different than it is now? And can we start to love the inner world of reading the books or having more time to watch movies or playing cards? Or can we bring that passion and that enthusiasm for still having a human body even into our later years?
Absolutely. Still having that, like you said, that enthusiasm. You could still be volunteering at that stage of life and sharing your wisdom with others and still getting up every morning and being active and challenging yourself as well.
And that's why I want to take care of this vehicle, because I want to be able to get out and do things. I think when our vehicle breaks down, we get more sedentary, we get more isolated, we'll probably be more lonely, lose connection, lose passion. So I'm really, you know, as my body is aging, starting to think, wow, Amy, if you want to stay passionate and present for every day of your life, you got to take care of this thing. Because I think it's really hard when you're ill and you're on a lot of medication and nobody's coming to see you and you're lonely. I can imagine how quickly the mental state would deteriorate.
Yeah, and as well, because you're in the Vata stage of life, and then if you're a high Vata constitution or if you have Vata imbalance, that leads to more mind spinning and leads to more of that fear coming in, because that's a part of a Vata imbalance. So I covered this a lot in Aging Gracefully with Ayurveda. It was a podcast I did a maybe a year or so ago now, but I'll link to it in the show notes. But there's a lot of making sure that you're really taking care of yourself, bringing good fats into the diet, because there's all that drying, of course, that's going on in the body. So good fats and lots of liquids, making sure you're eating really easy digestible foods, because you don't want that vata imbalance to come in and cause that agitation. You know, I just was talking to one of my friends recently, and she said that her mother, who is in an old folks home, and she, every autumn, she said her mind just goes. And I was like, well, that might make sense, because autumn is vata time. She goes, yeah, every autumn she gets a little hysterical. She goes, you know, she was saying she goes a little mad. And I was like, yeah, that makes sense, because it's just, she's already vata and she's in that vata stage of life. And now you bring in the vata season of autumn, that's going to really increase those imbalances. So it's really important as you age to keep lots of good fats in the diet, really take care of your body, really take care of your food is easy digestible, and make sure it's very grounding for the vata dosha. Do your Abhyanga massage. All those things can really help ease and calm the vata nervous system.
And can I just tell you, in addition to all of that, I agree 100%, but I am really discovering how much water my body actually needs. And vata is the dryness. You almost shrivel up. Yeah. And so I've made a point to start drinking between 70 and 90 ounces of water a day. Mm. And I feel like a different person. Oh. And my lips aren't dry and my skin isn't dry. Right. I don't feel hunger cravings as much. My pain is less. I mean, there's so much to be said for actually hydrating our bodies and our minds.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, it's like 70% of our body is made up of water. So we just like the earth. So we need to take a lot more in, especially as we're in autumn and winter as well. So yeah, that's really good advice. And I think sipping on hot water could to aid the digestion as you get older too. That can be really good, and room temperature water, but hot water really stimulates the digestive fire. And definitely avoiding any ice. You know, there's tendency, especially in the States, to hand iced drinks with meals all the time. So try avoid that ice, because that just slows everything down. But, you know, I want to talk now about, well, how do we incorporate people in the vata stage of life into our society a little bit more? How do we bring them in? And I have seen a couple of things on, I think it was on Facebook, some posts, really lovely, that there's a retirement home who also brought in a preschool into the same building. So these little kiddies, you know, 3 and 4 years old, are coming in every morning, and they come in and they say hello, you know, to all the elderly who are sitting there after breakfast. And the elderly have to take off their jackets and their shoes before they go into class. And then they go off and do their thing in another room. But I think having that energy of young kids coming in, I think that's just amazing. And they're keeping the elderly nimble as well, you know, having to manage with their buttons and zips on their coats and their shoes and so on. And it just, I, you watch the that. Videos, and it brings so much life.
I've also seen where, like a Humane Society or some kind of, you know, rescues have brought animals in to be petted and played with. And what a beautiful, beautiful thing for the elderly and for the animals that are sitting in cages all day. I mean, why aren't we doing more of this? It's just a no-brainer.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. It is a no-brainer. And two other things I've seen, and they just bring tears to my eyes. They're so beautiful. Is, I think it was in England, there was they did a trial run where, of course, all these poor students can't really afford accommodation in the cities, you know, especially in London, because it's really expensive real estate. So what they were doing is they were housing the student with an elderly person living maybe in an independent community, or they had a spare room. How cool is that? So the student gets maybe free or cheap digs, right? Rental. And then the elderly person has someone to hang out with. and to kind of care for. Isn't that brilliant?
It's so brilliant.
Right?
So brilliant.
And that, like, they were doing interviews with the student and with the elderly person, and there was such a bond between them. Oh, it was just so heartwarming. It's really just an excellent idea.
I agree. It's beautiful.
And then there was another one where there was this student, I think it was a Scottish guy, and he had this bike. He changed the bike. He had a bicycle, a regular bicycle, and in the front of it, he put this like seat, you know, like with a horse and cart, and they're taking people in the back. It was like one of those cart seats that people can sit in. And they were, so the cart piece was in the seat, was in front of him. So he's riding the bicycle, and then there's two people can sit in front looking forward. And so he would go to the elderly homes and take people out. So you see the elderly people, the two, you know, in this video, there was two women strapped in, you know, they had their little bell seat belts or whatever. And he's getting exercise, and they're having the time of their lives in the front of the bicycle going along with their little blanket across them and everything. And they're sitting very comfortably, and they're getting this little chariot ride. I thought it was brilliant, because the young guy, he's only in his 20s, is getting exercise and at the same time doing some beautiful community service, giving back. And I thought, what a great idea for bike paths. You know, I know in Ireland they just set up this whole greenway, which was old railway lines, and they converted them into bike paths, and it's just changed the whole communities. There's people out there every weekend now. There's cafes set up on these bike paths. It's just changed the whole way of living around the area. But how cool would it be to have these big carriage bicycles, and then you could go to an elderly home, take somebody out for the, you know, for an afternoon, and you're getting your workout at the same time, doing some community service and spending some time with some wisdom, somebody in the wisdom stage of life. I just thought that was so cool.
It is lovely. And I think each of us can do our own little version of that too. I mean, you talk to these cute little old men in the mornings down at the beach, and I used to belong to a gym, and you know, I was always the first one in there in the morning, and it was like four or five elderly men in their 70s, and they're working out, and you know, we'd put on the Frank Sinatra music that they like, and we'd all lift weights.
Right.
And it was so fun. It was just really, I think they liked my younger energy and smiles and joking, and it just was really a lovely way to start my morning.
Yeah, I think it's, you just get so much out of it. I, like you, when we started this conversation, we were saying, I just love hanging out with people who are older and just listening to their stories. I mean, I could do that all day. Remember, every time I would visit Ireland, I'd just, you know, go pick up my granny, and we'd go out for the afternoon, and it was like, tell me more stories about when dad was younger, or, you know, it's just, I love hearing those, and with it would become such nuggets of wisdom. And you know, if you had any troubles, and there would always be such wise words to kind of calm you down.
You know, that is my favorite thing, is asking my mentors who are in their 70s and 80s, you know, what would you do in this situation? Yeah. And just listening, I just find it fascinating. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the main theme from one of my mentors named Eleanor is slow down, breathe, just be still, observe. And when the wave comes, then get on the wave and ride it. Okay. But if you're swimming against the wave, or if you're trying to find a wave and there is no wave, she's like, Don't struggle so hard, honey.
Yeah.
Just like sit on your surfboard. She doesn't use the word surfboard, but just sit there and enjoy the water and the sunshine. And then when the wave comes, you're going to be rested and ready to ride it. But until then, don't try to paddle out to find a wave and get on the wave you thought you wanted, but you didn't want. And, you know, and so that is really, you know, the essence of what she tells me over and over and over. Isn't every time beautiful? I come to her. Yeah.
And what more do you need in life than to say, when life is struggling against you, chill out, take a breath. And when you're on the wave, go with it. When you're in the flow, go with it. I mean, that's essentially what it's all about.
Right. It's probably why she ends up saying that every time. And of course, I only contact her, not only, but I contact her a lot when I'm struggling and suffering and, oh my gosh, what should I do? And she's like, just sit back and chill. Yeah. And she's also taught me, like, there's some things that no matter how hard I struggle, it's probably not going to work out the way I wanted. And right. Can I be okay with that? You know?
Oh, that seems beautiful to have that. And I think for those in the pitta stage of life, I think we need to really evaluate how we are treating the elders in our community. So it starts with us, right? How we're treating the elders in our community. Are we having patience? Are we respectful? We look at the indigenous cultures and they're so respectful. The elders are looked up to. The grandmothers are looked up to. There's such wisdom there. They're revered for their wisdom. And I think that in our own way, each of us can bring that back into our lives. And especially if you have children, for your children to see how you respect the elderly. It's not a petty thing. It's like they can really add value to our lives.
Absolutely. I mean, my mentor had a emergency room visit a few weeks ago, and I've never stayed up till 3 o'clock in the morning, probably in my life, but we were there until 3 o'clock in the morning, and I was bright-eyed and bushy-tailed and awake and interested, and wow, is this what happens when you're elderly? Okay, you need this and that. Mm-hmm. Like, I just found the whole situation, you know, she wasn't in danger for her life or anything. Mm-hmm. But I found it so fascinating to just be the observer of it all. And I think it's interesting to watch how the elderly maneuver, you know, as they lose their physical body, but they have all this wisdom. And it's fascinating to me.
Yeah. And I think it is because we know that's our future. So it's almost like watching what's ahead for us, and really being mindful when you're around people who are elderly is not to rush so much around them. It can be a really good reminder for us to just chill out and take time. Yeah, they may move a little slower. Yes, they may talk a little slower. Yes, they may take time to remember things, but it's a good practice for those of us in the busy phase of life to chill out. And to take time, like, you know what, it's okay. This is good for me too. This is a good reminder for me to not be pushing all the time and not to be in such a rush. And I think it's really important for all of us just to take stock and take heed, like, this will be me someday. And how do I want to be treated in that situation? Not running past the person, you know, on the steps, and because it would elderly, they get shaky on their feet, and if you're flying past them, it can be very, very scary for them. So just be mindful when you're passing somebody on the sidewalk or, you know, asking them if they need assistance. And yeah.
Yeah. And I also think the perception that, you know, this is something that's going to happen to me, and oh no, I don't want this to happen to me. Could we instead really value our time with them and enjoy it and know that it's as much good for us as it is for them? I always say I like to participate in activities that are like petting a cat, where we're both getting enjoyment, me and the cat. And can we think of our relationship with elders like that? That, yeah, we're spending time and energy and love with, you know, with and on them, but we're also getting back so much enjoyment and love and kindness and ability to slow down. And, you know, so, I want to keep that perception that when I'm with this human being, it's benefiting both of us.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I think it's very important not to have the energy of feeling sorry for them. Like I said, I was earlier with some old men, or feeling the pity party for them. That's not necessary. And I have to remind myself of that all the time, that this is a stage of life they're in. And just, yes, enjoying the time you're spending with them and being curious about it and knowing that this is where we're all going, and at the same time really just soaking up the wisdom and soaking up the calmness that comes with that stage of life. But hopefully it's calm for most people, that just to be in it with them and to be present.
Yeah, I was just imagining you on the beach with these cute little old men, and then I thought, wow, when I'm that age, I don't want people feeling sorry for me. Right. I want them engaged with me, right, and happy to see me and like, yeah, hey, how's your day, honey? Yeah. You know, like, yeah. I hope that even, you know, as I age, people will still consider me an equal human being that they want to engage with and not just have sympathy for me.
Oh yeah. There's no fear of these old men. They're asking me out for an aperitif all the time.
You go, girl.
Tell you. These old men still have it going on. They're like, you're going to come for an aperitif with me?
Okay, you have to tell those of us who don't live in France. What is that? It's like a drink?
It's like a drink before dinner. Yeah, it's like you go for a drink, a glass of wine or something before dinner.
Yeah, so
there's no fear of these old men. Like, hey, let's hang out. But I think all of us can just take some time to think about how would we want to be treated when we age. We're on our way there, and take time out and really honor and respect our elders. And we really need to shift our way of thinking, and it starts with ourselves. And I do think that that conscious aging is coming into our awareness, and we definitely want to be more present as elders. And I think that as we age, especially our generation, we want to be active. Like we were saying, we want to be vital. We want to be active. We want to contribute. And I think now we see that we're reaching back into the past for answers to what's wrong with our society. I think that every elder has some value to add, and that we need that wisdom now to help us, because we're not on a good path right now, and we need that wisdom from our elders and that history and that, yeah, just the wisdom and the connection to really slow us down and to keep us present.
Absolutely. It's interesting. I'm hoping, you know, sometimes people are kind of ripping on the millennials and the generations X and Ys and Zs and all of this, but on some level, I'm starting to feel like they get this idea that elderly have wisdom, mm-hmm, more than you're in my generation.
Well, yeah. And just to go to that story I was talking about a moment ago, where these young students are living with elderly, but there, right, is an openness to it. And I think that's amazing.
It is. And even, you know, all these young kids that love people like Bernie Sanders, and it's kind of heartwarming to, you know, see them value and respect elderly people, you know. Yeah. I think it's cool.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we need to make it cool again and make it that, you know, elders are really respected and that they are revered in society. So I hope there is a shift, but definitely I would encourage each of us to just reflect on that and see how we are in our day-to-day lives with the elderly. Do we have, are we patient? Are we present? And like Amy said, it can benefit both of us when we are. So I'm going to leave it there, Amy. Thank you for that. It was a good conversation. It was one that I wanted to have. And I think just bringing the awareness to it is great. And bringing the awareness that even if you're in the pita stage of life, that you should still be thinking about this and thinking about aging and doing that spiritual inner journey as we do in yoga and Ayurveda. I think that will really help us ease through into the Vata stage of life with more peace in our heart.
That's a great place to leave it. Thank you so much.
So I'd love to hear your thoughts, those out there listening, on what you think of the aging and your thoughts on what myself and Amy talked about today. So go on over to the Elements of Ayurveda podcast Facebook group and leave your thoughts there. I look forward to hearing them. Thank you, Amy. I appreciate it so much. As always, such a pleasure. And let's connect again very soon.
Thank you.
Take care.
Bye.
I hope you enjoy that conversation with Amy. And just a reminder that I have that Daily Habits for Holistic Health program coming up starting April 27th. This online self-paced course is 28 days long. And this is where we're going to support each other and hold each other accountable as we bring in some great daily self-care practices that will support us as we age. And also we'll talk about the foundations of Ayurvedic healing so you can become your own healer. We'll talk about accessing your intuition. So really on starting out on that journey of self-discovery. You can just click on the link in the show notes or go to elementshealingandwellbeing.com/daily habits course. Also, I will put a link to the Facebook group, the Elements of Ayurveda podcast Facebook group, where you can tell us what your thoughts on today's show. I'd love to hear them. And I also want to remind you that I have my French Riviera Yoga and Ayurveda retreat coming up here on the Côte d'Azur in the little village I live in, Villefranche-sur-Mer, and that will be October 11th to 13th. 2019. So click on the link in the show notes or go to my website, elementshealingandwellbeing.com/retreat. Thank you for tuning in. If you haven't already done so, please subscribe and rate and review the show so other people can find it and we can spread the goodness of Ayurveda. Take good care of yourself, be well, and ciao for now.